Going. Going.
Run, run. Run, run. Run, run.
Dumba. Do you like that?
In the last installment, we related how Fred Dibnah, the Bolton steeplejack, gave in to his wife Alison and agreed to a holiday at the seaside.
Somebody were getting this up.
Steam engine rallies apart, it was the first holiday they'd ever taken as a family, and Fred seemed doomed to a whole week away from his chimneys and steam engines.
It appears to be on the wrong side altogether, yeah.
That should have been on that.
Sit on that and see what happens.
It's easier making steam boilers than putting one of these up.
But, as it turned out, he hadn't accepted his sentence to the seaside sitting down.
Oh, this is it, is it?
Oh, yes, this is it, yeah.
He had struck up a deal with an engineering works at Blackpool, by which they made a tube plate for his traction engine, and he demolished a chimney for them.
We'll see if it fits, Donald.
Now, he was back home with his present from Blackpool and able to resume a normal life.
Not so bad, that, Donald, considering we only knocked a little chimney down. Yeah.
Among people beyond earshot of his nightly operations, Fred enjoys a reputation for working quietly and delicately. And it was with this in mind that a local authority called him in to consider how the top chunk of an island might be chopped off without shattering the tranquility of their nature reserve.
Like, this whole valley from, like, Salford to Bolton is being made into a nature reserve, you see. Now, just of late, we've got all these wildfowl here that have short legs and web feet, and they can't get on this island because the sides are too steep and they want it levelling out a bit, you know, so it's like Blackpool and they can just wander up the beach. This valley were once full of coal mines from Bolton all the way to Salford, you know, there's like one every yard or two, you know, sort of thing. Like, it's a lot nicer now than what it used to be, you know. Like, nearer to Bolton, there were a great big tip, you know, millions of rats and flies and all sorts of rubbish, and when wind were blowing right road, like, you know, you needed a gas mask on. But all that's now covered over with acres of beautiful grass, you know, and trees planted on it. Yeah, I suppose in 20-odd, 30-odd years, when they've all grown, it'll look quite nice, you know. Be back to maybe how it were before we lot, the Victorians, mucked it all up.
Wait for the bump. Should have a shock absorber on it.
Jump for it. Oh, oh shit.
No brakes on a bolt.
Nearly fell in. Come back in about a fortnight. See you. You've not got to fall in, Donald. This is it, the summit. There's all holes in it, isn't there? Like, as though there's some wildlife about.
Might be some little shrews.
Let's have a look what it's like over this, then.
Oh, on this overhang, yeah. Fred.
Let's see how hard it is.
On the overhang.
Tell you what, it's bigger than it bloody looks when you get it, you know, don't it? Yeah. Be all right if it's all like this, eh? What we've got to do is get it from its present 15 foot tall down to about 3 feet or something like that, you know, which, as far as I can see, is going to entail a great deal of digging. Look at this. Side of an house here, covered. What we're going to do today is see how much we can get off it in a day, then base our price on that, you see, for shifting it. The thing is, it will be very simple to blow the thing up, but you've got to think about the all the fishes that are in the water and all the wildfowl, you see. They might not like it and decide to move off elsewhere. So it's got to be done silently and quietly, like in the old-fashioned way.
A big lump.
Oops. Bit of a landslide there. Nearly went with it then. This job's very dangerous, you know. I can't swim if I fall off this island, you know, going to drown. It's safer up top of a 200-foot fighter chimney. Like the desired effects, or the ducks can get on, eh?
Look, that's building up a bit.
Getting a bit of a show down there, Donald. Bloody lake's turning round. It's going to take us 12 months at this rate. Won't be easier to knock them six chimneys down than shift this, we are sure. What they want is some of these poor buggers who are out of work on job, eh?
With the coming of spring, the island had passed out of Fred's care. But the winter's work on the engine was showing results.
Mind your fingers inside. Give it a swing.
Right, well, it's
Super,
well, we've had to do it in a split pattern, you know, but we'll just see if it fits that shape then. Okay. It won't be a perfect fit until, because it'll have to take into consideration the contraction on the steel.
It looks nice, though. I'm very pleased with that.
And it goes back behind these rivets?
Yeah. Oh, now we've got this pattern, you know, we'll be able to get the casting done and get the wheels on.
Yeah.
If you turn that up, you know, to, you know, nice and straight, and then make a 3.5-inch piece up to about there, like, you know, something like that.
Yeah.
And then weld it on, stick it back in lathe, let Brian do it, you know. we won't get a good job then.
Too clever, that, is it?
Oh, yeah, very technical. No, without a doubt. Right, give it a whirl.
can get right. All right. Yes.
Hey, paying for this, Fred? Are you going to clean
your spout, sir? Well, I'll clean your spout, sir, but I'm going to pay Brian some beer money, you know. I thought of giving him 40 quid, like, you know.
Bugger, Brian, let's have your downspouts clean.
Well, all right, then. I'll do your downspouts and give Brian some as well. Very important, this part, you see, you know. Sort of, I can't do it, can I? So I've got to know somebody who can.
Spring brought Fred another boon, a £4,500 contract that would keep his family and leave a margin for further work on his engine.
This particular job is sort of a bit upsetting to me because it's like the last spinning mill in Bolton with a proper chimney, you know, and I'm going to wreck it. All that beautiful fancy work around the top. I've got to take all of that off and lower it down to the ground, you see. And this isn't quite as simple as just knocking bricks off top of a chimney. Here, there's no room at all, you know, and I've got to lower it all down in buckets, about 100 weight at once, you see. You know, I'd very much like to mend it and make it, you know, glorious again for another long period, but really, it's redundant. Nobody loves it no more. Nobody wants it anymore, and they've no bloody use for it because, you know, they've only got a toy boiler down at the bottom. You know, when I first started climbing chimneys, there were quite a lot of places on coal. I even had the great pleasure of working on one or two where they actually still shoveled it on by hand, and all the black foul smoke used to come out. But that stuff, you know, it used to come out at top and all the gutters in the immediate neighbourhood and all old years' lace curtains rotted away. But this blue stuff from the oil makes you cough and splutter worse than Capstan Full Strength. It's a bit like putting your mouth around somebody's exhaust pipe, you know, up there, like, not very nice. In the other epic thing we did about climbing chimneys, you know, I was criticised for saying, you know, I had a few pints before I climbed up. But, you know, I'd like to say that, sort of, you want to try this bloody job sober, you know. Yeah, if I've had a couple of pints of beer, you know, I don't, you know, think I'm King Kong-like sort of thing. You know, take it that little bit easier, you know, and more cautious. The thing is that once you've got up that first bloody ladder, you've only got to make one wrong move and you're dead. You know, I mean, them boards, there's great gaps in them, you know. I mean, you could put one foot through a space and not even fall off, but smash your bloody leg in two pieces and then you'd feel a bit of a fool. Well, fire brigade's no good because the ladder's not long enough. Somebody would have to come and rescue you with an helicopter, you know, which is a bit of a look, you know, we can't have any of that, can we? Well, when you've had a pint or two and you're stuck up on top of a big factory chimney and sort of the calls of nature become imminent, you can either have a go down the middle or over the edge, you know, whereby they think it's raining in the next field. One instance that comes to mind where we had this bucket full of cement water and kept having a go in this. And then at the end of the day, we decided to throw it off, like, you know, pitch it out, like, over the side of the ship, you see. There's a bloke at the bottom with a magnificent bright red Alfa Romeo sports car. And when we came down, it was summertime, and all these beautiful red motor car were covered with white cement urinated spots. All over it, drying very well in the sun, you see. This contraption I sort of invented myself purely through watching the steeplejacks of like 1940 and 50. One famous firm from Manchester would arrive and just commandeer a skip out the mill and put four ropes, one on each corner, and like they'd literally pull the damn thing up by hand and put as many bricks in as they thought were sort of necessary and then lower it down, you know. And then I saw an improvement on that, two milk churns on a similar sort of setup that we've got here. But you've still got to lower the one down, sort of just let it come down at 2 mile an hour, which it like took 5 minutes for the bloody thing to get from the top to the bottom. And one day it dawned on me that if you had a brake drum on the haulage system somewhere, you could like control the thing yourself. Mind, the brake's on all the time. And when the can's full of bricks, which amounts to about 100 weight, I just lift up the lever and down it goes and the empty and comes up, you see. And then Donald down at bottom knocks the catch and out come the bricks, and as long as we can keep it going all day, like, we're in business. Up here, you get sort of rather ideas of grandeur, you know. You're sort of looking down on all these humble rows of little houses and sort of, you know, it makes me glad that, you know, I'm up here and not having to open my front door and go inside this bloody place, you know, instead of being free like a bird. Like, I often think that, you know, my sort of lot or life is, you know, it's more exciting and varied than most people's. You know, they never, you know, sort of have anything exciting, you know, unless they're having a bloody strike or something, you know, sort of. Like, steeplejacking, that's one thing that, you know, that appealed to me because I think basically I'm lazy, you know, like, sort of a job where. Some days when it rains, I'm quite happy because I can go home and do something on my engine, you see. Whereas if I were tied to a machine in a factory or an office, you know, you'd be, you know, like watching the bloody clock all day. People say, are you not bored knocking all them bricks off? And, well, the answer is, like, no, really, because the job's so reasonably simple that You can sort of carry on doing it, and you've part of your mind's conscious for the safety part of it, and the other part you can let wander away to more pleasant things, you know, like mending steam engines. All right, give us the exhaust part, Donald. Should all fit like we had it on before, like. Go on. Looks all right, then. Yeah. Well, it looks all right, that now, doesn't it, Donald?
Okay.
Yeah. Quite right. Splendid. Ah. You know, I said I reckon about 4 years and we'd have the bloody thing on its feet, you know, rolling. I can't see us being licked in any way for finish it off in 2 years. It won't be completely finished, but at least the bloody thing will run. You know, which from when we bought it, if you remember, it'd be a far cry from that, you know, a pile of rust with rude words chalked on the side of it like this engine is buggered. But it's not so buggered now, is it? It looks, you know, it's coming along like. So it looks a lot healthier than it did when we got it 2 years ago. Right, Donald. That's one in. Come in. Put two to the four in and not the one in. Put it through with another one.
Fingers from underneath.
Hang on. Yeah. I've got this end. Up a bit. Right. It's all right, that one, isn't it? I'm very pleased with that.
Good fit, that.
I think we'll have a brew now, eh? Yeah. Come on, let's go and sort the wife out. Mm. Very handsome, that spring, don't you think? Looks all right, that, doesn't it? Never know it were...
You leave that in now.
It's not been made in 1912. Yeah. Since you were last here, I've bought my house off the Earl of Bradford. And the agent died, you see. This character rung up from Cambridge and said, you know, we're coming up to have a chat with you, you see. And Mr. just forgotten his name, but he liked to look at your steam engines. And I thought, ah, oh, they're in Cambridge, you see. The big steam men down there, you know. And they would come up and I'll impress them with my steam engines and then I'll get a bit knocked off price at the house. Anyway, up they came and, you know, it happened to be raining that day, so we didn't bother going to work and we had steamroller taking over in the shed. And this man from Cambridge appeared to be quite impressed and said, well, how much will you give me? Well, in the, you know, for this here house, you see. And I wandered around showing him all the bad points. So there's a 9-inch bulge on the back, you know, and it's a bloody wonder it's not all in the river, you see. And a bit of time went by, and cutting a long story short, like, we got it for £5,000 and all this land and everything, you know. And so now it's up to me to, you know, stop the bloody thing slipping into the river. Right, next one, Donald. This will go any road round, wash the same on both sides. You don't fall off there.
No.
You've got the square bit out the middle.
Well, very.
It don't matter really.
Mm.
Just keep screwing. It'll do that. Right. Oh, that's it. Beautiful.
That should hold it up.
Oh, I'll be here in 150 years, that.
Well, you won't.
Once upon a time, it used to be a gatehouse, and in the historical buildings of Bolton, they've got it down as a single-storey gatehouse, and yet they don't know about this bit underground. You know, we live like semi-subterranean, like bunny rabbits. When we first came, you know, noticed this great nasty bulge on the back, you know, and I thought, I know why they've let me have this cheap, you know, sort of the bloody back's going to fall out. And then one day, I think I was lying in bed and there was one hell of a bang. And I thought, that's it, the back's fell out, the outside fore and aft fell out of the bloody place. And we're under a bit of a misapprehension. It was actually a gas explosion, you know. The wife come running upstairs screaming, no eyebrows, a big hole burnt in front of her dress. Bloody gas cooker had blown up.
Hitherto, Fred had regarded his domain merely as a shelter for his steam engines and his family. Now he began to feel pride in its possession and its idyllic situation.
My house, which is sort of just over there behind all them trees, like in between there and here, there's the river, and then this, of course, is the cemetery, you know, where we'll all end up eventually. In here, actually, somewhere, there's the first and, I think, only man in Bolton to be killed by a lion. It seems that they'd not quite got the preparations right. Like, they got this big cage at the local Wakes Week thing in 1890-something. And they had these braziers with big long iron rods, you see, and somebody forgot to light the bloody fires, you know. Anyway, the lion got the man, and there no iron rods, red hot iron rods, for get them off him, and so he ended up in here, poor fella, you know. Then my dad used to tell me a tale about they had a big flood once, and it washed one or two of them down the river, you know, like the corpses there is. The thing is that, you know, whether there's any truth in it or not, I don't know, but I know down in that riverbed there's all sorts of gravestones. Like, when my time comes, you know, I think you couldn't really find a more peaceful and nicer cemetery than this. You know, it's nice and quiet, you know, and they cut the grass regular. Not that you'd notice, like, when you're 6 foot under, but it's much nicer than being turned into a little plastic bag or a tin can full of fag ash, isn't it? And sort of besides, I wouldn't mind building my own gravestone, you know, like make one like a chimney with a staging round the top, you know, lightning conductor on and everything. Very fancy, you know, one with a beautiful fancy top on it.